came to the emergency room after cutting his left wrist superficially in a suicide gesture. He did this following an argument with his parents about his girlfriend. He went into the bathroom and came out showing them the wound and saying, "See what you have made me do." He has always been a very dramatic and emotional person, but this characteristic has become more prominent in the last 6 months since he started seeing a girl whom his parents describe as flashy and unsuitable. He describes himself as a dramatic person who likes to make the most of a situation and tells how he got out of a previous relationship by telling the girl he was an epileptic and throwing a fit in her company while they were in line outside a theater. How he seduced another girl by swallowing 100 aspirins in her presence because she wouldn't go to bed with him. He is currently a student at a fashion design school, but insists on living with his parents, who are the only people who can understand and support me. Over the past 3 months, he has had serious problems with his current girlfriend, who is urging him to move out of his parents' home and live with her. He has had problems sleeping, and he is worrying about his future at college and his relationship with his girlfriend. He has been losing weight because he is worrying so much and feels down in the dumps because no one really cares about him or understands him. He thinks he is becoming a failure at school and in his relationships, and he has been contemplating ending it all. His schoolwork has suffered because he cannot concentrate and no longer enjoys it as much as he used to. About the uncertainty of her future. She felt confused and directionless, and these feelings often interfered with her ability to concentrate on her schoolwork. Alice had looked forward to coming to college in her freshman year, and when she arrived, was excited by the diversity of people she'd met. Sometimes she enjoyed being with her arty, more way out kind of radical friends, and at other times she felt more comfortable with her traditional, more moderate, preppy friends. In the past year, however, she had increasingly had the feeling that she did not fit into any one group of friends and was confused about who she really was. She experienced this not only with regard to her friends, but in her academic studies as well. A second semester junior, she still did not have a clear idea of what she really wanted to study, or in a larger sense, what she wanted to do with her life after finishing college. At the end of her sophomore year, she had decided on chemistry, but then had changed to sociology at the beginning of her junior year, and more recently had changed to art history. Yet she was not completely happy with the choice. It's as if I want to do everything, and yet I don't really want to do anything in particular. Bill, age 5, was brought by his mother for evaluation because she felt that he was not progressing and developing like other children. She says he speaks only in simple phrases, that he does not use the pronoun I to refer to himself, and does not say yes or no to indicate agreement. He repeats what he has been told. Upon inquiry, it turns out that the only communication Bill has with others is repeating what he has heard. Echolalia. Does speak to himself at times, but in a disjointed, disconnected, rambling manner. So these were the only spontaneous complaints of another question of her revealed that Bill does not relate to other children and is totally uninterested in other youngsters. Although he seems to recognize his parents, he is not affectionate or responsive to them. His eye contact is very poor, and he is described as looking through people. When approached affectionately, he shrinks away and screams! Bill is described as being extremely interested in music and very good at remembering songs and tunes. He spends a great deal of time listening to records while he rocks back and forth or from foot to foot. At other times, he grinds his teeth and stares at his hands while making motions with his fingers. His mother reports that he was fine until he was about 3 when he began to change. Within a few months, he began to act in company as though no one were around. And he did not seem to recognize people who were familiar to him. He started spending long periods of time staring into space, looking self-absorbed, as if he were deaf. Since then, he has been remote and inaccessible. Hello, young lovers, wherever you are. You see here before you a student of music, age 19, who has been ill for about a year. The highly gifted patient, without any tangible cause while studying music, became depressed, felt ill at ease and lonely, made all manner of plans, which he always gave up, for changing his place of residence and his profession. For he could come to no fixed resolutions. During a visit to Munich, he felt as if people in the street had something to say to him, and as if he were talked about everywhere. He heard an offensive remark at an inn at the next table, which he answered rudely. Next day, he was seized with the apprehension that his remark might be taken as less majesté. He heard that students asked for him at the door, and he left Munich post haste with every precautionary measure because he thought himself accompanied and followed on the way. Since then, he has overheard people in the street threaten to shoot him and to set fire to his house, and on that account, he burned no light in his room. In the street, voices pointed out the way he ought to go so as to avoid being shot. Behind doors, windows, hedges, pursuers seemed to lurk everywhere. He also heard long conversations of not very flattering purport to his person. In consequence of this, he withdrew altogether from society, yet behaved in such an ordinary way that his relatives whom he visited did not even believe him. At last, the many mocking calls which he heard every day before, shooting at himself. After about 6 months, he felt more free, comfortable, enterprising, and cheerful. He began to talk a lot, to compose, criticized everything, concocted great schemes, and was insubordinate to his teacher. The voices still continued, and he recognized in the whisperings of master spirits. Hallucinations of sight now became very marked. The patient saw Beethoven's image radiant with joy at his genius. Saw Goethe, whom he had abused in a threatening attitude. Masked old men and ideal female forms floated through his room. Of lightning and glorious brilliancy of colors, which he interpreted partly as the flowing out of his great genius, partly as attestations of applause from the dead. He regarded himself as the Messiah, preached openly against prostitution, wished to enter into an ideal connection with a female student of music, whom he sought for in strange houses, composed the great song of love, and on account of this priceless work was brought to the hospital by those who envied him as he stood. The patient is quite collected and gives connected information as to his personal circumstances. He is clear as to time and place, but betrays himself by judging his position falsely, inasmuch as he takes us for hypnotizers who wish to try experiments with him. He does not look upon himself as ill, at the most as somewhat nervously overexcited. Through diplomatic questions, we learn that all people know his thoughts. If he writes, the words are repeated before the door. In the creaking of boards and the whistle of the train, he hears calls, exhortations, orders, threats. Christ appears to him in the night, or a golden figure as the spirit of his father. Colored signs of special meaning are given. In prolonged conversation, the patient very produces threads and produces finally a succession of fine phrases which wind up unexpectedly with some facetious question. His mood is arrogant, conceited, generally condescending, occasionally transitorily irritated, or apprehensive. The patient speaks much and willingly, talks aloud to himself, and marches boisterously up and down the ward, interests himself more than is desirable in his fellow patients, seeking to cheer them and to manage them. He is very busy, too, with letter writing and composing, but only produces fugitive, carelessly jotted down written work with numerous marginal notes. Fearful girl. S.S. is a 21-year-old girl who was hospitalized because she had not improved after a year of outpatient psychotherapy. On admission, she stated, "I have fears of food. I have fears of something happening to my family. I cannot sleep. I get depressed. I become tense, anxious, and agitated." She was cooperative and pleasant, gave a coherent and reasonably complete history, and denied delusions or hallucinations, although she had sometimes been afraid that she might someday have hallucinations. At times she speaks of feeling very hopeless and of feeling that suicide is the only answer in the end, but usually she does not appear to feel this and more often seems rather to enjoy the uniqueness which she feels her present illness possesses. Occasionally, a really depressing thought will strike her. At such times, she will appear truly depressed, with ready tears and a more convincing attitude of despair. Ideas suggesting irreparable organic damage or deficits in the field of emotional experience seem most capable of provoking these markedly depressed moods, which are usually short-lived. S.S. states the beginning of her illness to a night in her 15th year when she overheard her parents having intercourse. She became sexually aroused and describes feeling there was something wrong with me. Like, I was going up in an elevator and I thought it would never go away. I thought maybe I couldn't experience any sexual feeling. Soon afterward, the word fuck was popping in my mind and kept going over and over, and not for a minute could I get it out of my thoughts. Fuck, fuck, fuck. A couple of months later, it was still going over in my mind. Fuck. And I told myself, why should you think so? Not tell to anyone if they ask you what is wrong. So I changed it to worry. Worry, worry, worry. I don't know how I ever got through school ever since I was 15. Worry, worry kept rotating in my mind continually. I got so I couldn't swallow. I couldn't even eat. Food did not agree with me because I was worried. The word fuck made me feel nauseated. I couldn't sleep. I would lie there with agitation with the idea of the word going over and over. Worry, worry, worry. Since that time, she has had a number of similar preoccupations. The fear that she would someday be so concerned about the cleanliness of food that she would be able to eat only kosher food. The fear that she would come to believe in Christ and thus upset her Orthodox Jewish family. The worry that she might upset her sister so much that they would become insane. She also had some compulsions, such as having to turn off the light 6 times each night, and having to leave her shoes in a parallel line when she went to bed. But these were not elaborate or time-consuming. She has had many crushes on boys, but no sexual relationships. She has stated in an interview that she does not know whether she is male or female, that she fears she cannot lead a normal life or be happy. She appears to have had no close girlfriends, but to have been intensively and ambivalently involved with her extended family. She finished high school and a 1-year business course and was able to work as a clerk until a year ago when she came home from work with a dazed appearance and refused to talk to anyone, saying, "You wouldn't understand." It was at this time that she was referred for outpatient treatment. She spent the year at home doing very little except trying to understand her illness. On the ward, she is described as careless and listless, staying in bed all day with no initiative. She manifests a belief in thought magic and also shows a fluctuating appraisal of reality and at times she manifests a belief in thought magic. Thought magic. Worry. Fuck. She manifests a belief in thought magic and... Fuck! And also shows a fluctuate. Fuck! And also shows a fluctuating appraisal of reality and at times deep personalization. Fuck! A 23-year-old unmarried male school teacher presents for help with his distress. A 23-year-old unmarried male school teacher presents for help with his distress. A 23-year-old unmarried male school teacher presents for help with his distress about his preoccupation with homosexuality. He has had almost no dating experience with women. He has felt unmasculine since childhood and different from most boys as he was growing up. He was frail and unsuccessful in sports, and he became a loner in most activities, concentrating particularly on his education, in which he excelled. Since puberty, he felt fearful of girls. Expecting to be rejected. He began at that time to fantasize about dominating and being appreciated by strong, handsome boys his age or older. He would masturbate to this fantasy and find the ideas increasingly pleasurable. Now, although he has not yet had any overt homosexual experience, he is constantly preoccupied with a physical desire for homosexual contact. Yet, in a social sense, he is repulsed by the idea, finds it totally shameful and unacceptable to his social and cultural goals. He wants to rid himself of these homosexual ideas and be able to make love to a woman. He has intense fear that he will be impotent with women and further humiliated. During childhood, he felt close to his mother, whom he felt assured loved him, but distant and isolated from his father. He felt he never measured up to his father's standards. And was unable to discuss much with him. He now feels both respect and intense resentment toward him. He chronically has low self-esteem and is often depressed, even at times suicidal when faced with the emptiness of the future. On the few occasions on which he has dated women, the patient had only weak sexual feelings and an intense feeling of inadequacy and failure. Therefore, he goes to elaborate efforts to avoid being introduced to new women for fear of being unable to follow through. Yet he hates himself for this. He feels he has no one with whom he can talk openly.
Thank you.
not showing them the wound. See what you have made me do. He has always been a very dramatic and emotional person, but this characteristic has become more prominent in the last 6 months since he started seeing a girl who his parents describe as flashy and unsuitable. He describes himself as a dramatic person who likes to make the most of a situation and tell Tony he got out of a previous relationship by telling the girl he was a bit romantic and throwing a fit in her company while they were in line outside of the theater. And how he seduced another girl by swallowing 100 aspirins.
Thank you. outside my window.